Okay, so who loves this book? Yeah, pretty important book. What makes the Bible important and special more than any other book in the world? Of course, if you believe it. So what's God's word? Different, you know, God's word, the word of God. That's why we call it the Holy Bible, because God's holy and therefore his word is holy. And the way in which it came about is remarkable. And the way in which God has preserved his word through different translations and all that, we keep going, and the way he's preserved the original, at least the copied manuscripts, is remarkable too. But to believe this book truly in your heart, not just because mum and dad told you so, is a spiritual blessing. To truly believe and receive the words in this book is a gift from God. And we should be very humbled and grateful, because Jesus said to his disciples, "Blessed are your eyes, for they see." And we are truly blessed. So if Jesus Christ is your Lord and Saviour, and you believe the Bible to be the Word of God, then let's say this from the heart and really think about what we're saying, because we're going to need this affirmation as we look at this sermon. So this is my Bible. Holy and true like its author. I am what it says I am. I have what it says I have. I can do in his strength what it says I can do. Today I'll be taught the word of God. I boldly confess. My mind is alert. My heart is receptive. And by grace, I'll never be the same. For Jesus' sake. Amen. So you'll see that we're back in Mark's gospel after a week's break, and we're in coming to the third last chapter of the gospel. It's one of the, I think it is the shortest gospel, and we come to the third last chapter, chapter 14 that we just read, verses 1 to 9. So let's pray and we'll get stuck into it. Lord, when we think about the gift of revelation that you've given us, written down for everyone to read, but the understanding comes by your Spirit. In line with a Spirit-cultivated, humble, receptive heart, and that's a gift too. But Lord, the revelation that comes is not just for sake of knowledge, it's the knowledge of Jesus, the knowledge of God. That's the greatest knowledge in the universe, and knowledge that hits the heart and is able to bring salvation, able to change our eternity from heading in the direction of judgment and hell and to peace and safety and heaven with you, and able to overcome the power of sin in our life. And so, Lord, we just ask you now that you would be gracious to us and free us from any things that will hinder us and affect our hearts from allowing your Spirit to open our hearts to your word today. And the same for me, Lord, that you will clear away anything that will hinder your Spirit to speak through his word. And so, Lord, fill me afresh for this task that you set before me. And Lord, may we see Jesus more and more and more so than we ever have, Lord. His glory, his beauty, his value. And we will be changed. Our lives would be a fragrance of offering and worship more and more in response to who you are and your amazing worth and value. So we just ask for this in Jesus' name. Amen. So let me begin with a reflective question. Have you stepped back and contemplated life, your life, recently? If not at all. Contemplating the reality that you have only one life, as Mark's gospel, Christianity explored one life, what it's all about. And so one life, of course, this side of heaven, one life. Then after this life, you will meet God, the Creator, who then will determine your eternal destiny. That's a staggering thought, isn't it? Sometimes we need to step back from the mundane, trivial things we do every day and step back at the big picture. God's word, the Bible, says that this life is extremely short and extremely important in respect to preparation for what's to come. And we have no idea how short our life will be. You cannot determine, as much as you try to eat all the healthy foods and do all the exercise, you cannot determine how long or how short you will live. So do you want to live a purposeful, unwasted life? Yes or no? A purposeful, unwasted life. Or are you going to be like the many people who are on the broad road that leads to what? Damnation, destruction. Billions of people throughout history, billions of people who will get to the end of their life and be confronted with the terrifying reality that they have completely wasted their life in the eyes of God and will suffer the eternal consequences of that choice. So the unwasted life or the wasted life, which one do you want for your life? In today's Bible passage from Mark's Gospel, we come across a lady who extravagantly, you'll hear that word often in this sermon, extravagantly expresses her faith. Extravagance has this idea, for those who aren't, like there's a few here who are probably more fluent in Chinese than English. Who wants to explain extravagance? It's this sort of this overflowing, excessive, it can be a negative thing, but in this sermon it's a positive thing, a reckless, you know, outpouring of something, and in this case worship. So there's this sense that this lady, we come across a lady who extravagantly expresses her faith, extravagantly expresses her love and worship of Jesus by taking something of hers that is very expensive and precious to her and uses it on Jesus. And we'll see some view her act as excessive and wasteful and were outraged. Verse 5, you'll see that in verse 5. There were some who said to themselves indignantly, why was the ointment wasted like that? But Jesus thought otherwise. He didn't think that it was a waste. He said this in verse 6, leave her alone. Why do you trouble her? She has done a what? What does it say? A beautiful thing to me. Her act is not wasteful, Jesus said. It is beautiful. It was a glorious thing she did to and for Jesus. This is why I've titled the message, The Unwasted Life. I think we get to the very essence of what a beautiful, unwasted life is according to Jesus. I don't know about you, but I want my life to count. I don't want to get to the end of my life and then learn that I wasted it. Though there will be aspects of all of our lives where we have wasted it, that's covered by the blood of Jesus. I want to live a life that has meaning, a life that is purposeful and beautiful in the eyes of my God and my Saviour. This is how I'm going to approach the passage, okay, guys? Firstly, we're going to venture through verses 1 to 9, drawing out the meaning, hopefully giving us a greater understanding of what's going on, Okay, and then we'll look at firstly the context in verses 1 and 2, then the act itself, the act of extravagant worship in verse 3, then the negative response by some of the guests in verses 4 and 5, and then Jesus' response in verses 6 to 9. And after we work our way through the text, I want to ask two questions that I think the passage answers for us. Number one, what is the essence of the unwasted life? And number two, what is the effect of the unwasted life? So look at the text with me. Let's start with the context. Okay, Mark 14, 1 to 2. Mark chapter 14, 1 to 2. It was now 2 days before the Passover and the feast of unleavened bread, and the chief priests and the scribes were seeking how to arrest him by stealth and kill him. And they said, not during the feast, lest there be an uproar from the people. So after devoting a whole chapter, if you remember, Mark, to Jesus' teaching on the signs that Jesus predicted leading up to the destruction of the temple and his second coming, Mark, as he continues to record events leading up to Jesus' death and resurrection, helps us, the reader, to grasp when this event occurred, when this event happened. And he states that there was only 2 days, guys, 2 days to go to Jewish Passover and the beginning of the week-long festivities, the Feast of Unleavened Bread. And more importantly, it is 2 days before Jesus' ministry climaxes, comes to a head, reaches its high point, with his glorious death on the Friday and his subsequent victorious resurrection on the Sunday, in which Jesus has already foretold 3 times prior that he must die and he must rise. It's part of his ministry. It's part of why he came from heaven to earth. This will be the main thing, the real deal. And with only 2 days to go to Passover, the Jewish authorities who oppose Jesus are anxious to get rid of him by not just putting him behind bars, but they wanted to get rid of him permanently by killing him. Matthew 26:3, a parallel passage to this passage, tells us that these religious leaders actually held a meeting in the palace of the Jewish high priest at the time, Caiaphas, to plot against Jesus so that they can arrest him and murder him. But there's one big problem: Jesus' popularity. Not everyone hated Jesus like them. A lot of them did, but not everyone hated Jesus. There were many who had come to believe in Jesus by receiving his teaching. There were even more than likely, who didn't believe in Jesus, but yet they were still pro-Jesus, okay? They were still for Jesus because they or their family member or a friend had their lifelong sickness taken away by Jesus. Or they had a demon cast out of them by Jesus. Or they were paralyzed and were healed, and their limbs were healed by Jesus. Or their eyesight restored. Or their bellies filled with the miraculous feeding of five loaves and 2 fish. Not everyone who was healed or saw miracles of Jesus believed. So with so many people still pro-Jesus, to openly arrest him could cause a public uproar. This is the last thing they wanted, because it could jeopardize their reputation, which they so loved, and it could upset the Romans, which they so didn't want to do. So they looked at getting rid of Christ by stealth. Okay, and it's important to know that this is Passover time, guys. People are flocking in from all over the Middle Eastern area. Thousands. The population of Jerusalem supposedly expanded from like 50,000 to 250,000 to 300,000 people when Passover happened. And just think about how many people would have known about this miracle worker from Nazareth, the word getting out. about this Jesus. Isn't it interesting that Jesus' opponents didn't come from the outside in pubs and brothels? A lot of those who were pro-Jesus actually came from those places. They came from, these opponents came from the inside, the religious politicos, and even from one of Jesus' so-called disciples, what's his name? Who we'll see in the next few weeks, who will do him in, Judas. As a little parenthesis, the church tends to look for threats from without and ignore threats from within, which are actually more dangerous. And remember from 2 weeks ago, Jesus prophesied in the previous chapter that false prophets and false Christs will come and deceive, which means that they are false. They come in the name of truth. They come in the name of Christ and teach supposedly things that are from God, but they're not. And so that's the context. Let's look at the act in verse 3 of extravagant worship. Verse 3. And while he was at Bethany in the house of Simon the leper, as he was reclining, that's not sitting, they didn't have chairs back then, remember? They would sit around in a circle and they would have like a little table and they would be lying down with their feet shooting out to the back, reclining. That's how they ate and had hospitality. So though he was reclining at table, and a woman came with an alabaster flask of ointment of pure nard, very costly, and she broke the flask and poured it over his head. So Jesus is having a meal at Simon's house. Simon's the leper, who no doubt was healed of his leprosy by Jesus and became a disciple. And then this unnamed woman, who may have been in the house already, spontaneously and extravagantly worships Jesus, demonstrating her overflowing love for her precious Saviour by pouring out her prized possession on him. Now, she displays the great value and supreme worth Jesus is to her by anointing him with her extremely costly perfume. This is not the only time this specific type of extravagant worship occurred to Jesus. Okay, and I'm guessing from women, because I don't think men, you know, the perfume wouldn't have, you know, they probably would have used something else. But okay, three times the Gospels record this sort of worship. Early on in Jesus' ministry, Luke records in chapter 7 of his Gospel a similar thing. Jesus is a guest for dinner, if you remember the story, at a Pharisee's place named Simon. How's that for irony? Then a prostitute enters the house and in extravagant worship pours out her alabaster flask of perfume on Jesus while washing his feet with what? Her hair? Not just a rag like it's taken on the form of a servant and slave. She got her hair, her crown of glory, guys, and got Jesus' dirty feet and started washing it. And her tears, using her tears as the liquid. And we will turn to that story at the end, Lord willing. The second time this sort of extravagant worship took place, I believe, occurred in Mary and Martha and Lazarus's house in Bethany. Mary and Martha and Lazarus are sisters and brother. And in Bethany, and just 4 days prior to the unnamed lady's worship in Simon's house from our passage, many people believe that this incident in John 12 that we're about to read is the same incident here in Mark 14, and I disagree. I disagree, and you'll see some of the reasons why. Okay, I don't think it's the same incident. First of all, I think it happened earlier, I'll show you. Look at John. Turn to John chapter 1. John chapter 12. John 12. John 12, we'll read the story starting in verse 1. Now, I know with John's account, gospel, it's not so much chronological and it's more thematic and theological, and I understand that. But he says in verse 1, 6 days before the Passover. In Mark's gospel, it says 2 days before. That says to me that this may be a different incident, okay? Jesus therefore came to Bethany, same town, where Lazarus was, whom Jesus has raised from the dead. Think about that. I'm going to the house to a guy who once died and I raised him from the dead. That's pretty astonishing. Verse 2. So they gave a dinner for him there. So I'm guessing this is their house. You know what I'm saying? Mary, Martha, and Lazarus' house. Two sisters and a brother living together. And so they gave him a dinner there. Martha served. As you remember the story of Mary and Martha, she loved serving. And Lazarus was one of those reclining with him at the table. Verse 3. Mary therefore took a pound of expensive ointment made from pure nard, anointed the feet of Jesus, not where the other account says anointed his head, and wiped his feet with her hair. There we go, that humility. Amazing humility and worship. The house was filled with the fragrance of the perfume, but Judas Iscariot, one of his disciples who was about to betray him, said, "Why was this ointment not sold for 300 denarii and given to the poor?" That's the same criticism with exactly the same criticism, but his motive, I believe, is different. Verse 6, he said this not because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief, and having charge of the money bag, he used to help himself to what was put in it. So Jesus had his 12 disciples, and they had to carry money around to give alms to the poor and all that, and to provide for the needs. And have a guess who Jesus allowed to carry the money? Judas. And you know what he did? He would take money for himself. He was a rotten apple. From the beginning, not all of a sudden, oh, I'm going to betray Jesus. This guy was rotten, and Jesus chose him. Think about that. Does your head in a knot? Then he says this. Verse 7, Jesus said, "Leave her alone so that she may keep it for the day of my burial. For the poor you always have with you, but you do not always have me." Sounds familiar, but do you see the differences? So let's head back to Mark 14. I don't think it's the same account. So I don't think it's Mary in Mark 14. Okay, let's head back to Mark 14, which I believe is the third separate act of worship where a woman pours out her very costly perfume on Jesus in her worship of him. Now, before we try and get a bit of understanding of the cost involved in this devotional act, let me draw your attention to the fact that though this woman was and is still unknown to us, the reader, her example isn't unknown. Jesus prophetically promised this in verse 9. Look at verse 9. "And truly I say to you, wherever the gospel is proclaimed in the whole world, what she has done will be told in memory of her." Jesus promised and knew that he'll preserve this story for future generations. And by us and the countless number of people throughout history who have read what she did in the Bible, we are fulfilling Jesus' promise in verse 9. So how extravagant was this lady's devotion to Jesus? Before we even get to the expensive perfume, we are talking about an alabaster flask. Alabaster is like this, and what I learned this week is a type of gypsum, and it's white or translucent in its pure form, and it's found in limestone deposits in caves and at the exit of springs, and it's often used for making ointment jars, and was considered a luxury item. Why? Because it was a very expensive item to have, and this lady was willing to break it on someone more precious and dear to her than this flask. But her breaking it had a purpose, and that was to get the even more expensive liquid inside out. The flask was filled with a rare perfume, ointment made from the root of a plant grown in the Himalayas, long way away from Israel. Because of how rare it was so costly, guys. She more than likely had about a pound, 12 ounces, or in our metric measure, 300 to 400 mils of this stuff. We are told in verse 5 by those who scolded this lady that it was worth more than 300 denarii. And I'm sure I've got a denarii in my pocket, not, so we need to, well, what is a denarii? One denarii is equivalent to a day's wage of a labourer. One day's wage, one denarii. So 300 was equivalent to a year's wage of a labourer back in those days. So in our day, let's say that the average wage of a labourer, $40,000 to $60,000 in 300 to 400 mils. The perfume or the cologne I use, don't know if you've noticed that, I actually, you know, sometimes I smell and know, but I use a cologne and it's called Calvin Klein Obsession. And just this week it ran out, or it's coming to rain, and I paid $50, man, for 125 mils. And I know that there's a lot more expensive things, but that's really expensive for me. $50 for 125 mils, and that will last me years, like the other one did. And so, but compare that, 125 mils, that's a third of what this lady had, times $50, that's $150, and for me that's a lot, and this lady's amount was equivalent to $40,000 in her day, a year's wage. You work for a year and that's how much was in that. But this gesture, by this gesture, she shows the incomparable worth of Jesus. What she was willing to sacrifice shows how much she loved, how much she treasured, how much she adored her Savior and Lord. And our response and the response of the other guests in Simon's house who saw this, who witnessed this, should have said, "Yes, praise God, that is terrific. Jesus is worthy of this, and he's worthy of far more than this." But unfortunately, not everyone thought this way because they didn't see the value of Jesus. So let's go to the criticism, the negative response of some of the guests. Verse 4 and 5. There were some who said to themselves indignantly, I struggle with that word, "Why was the anointment wasted like that? For this anointment could have been sold for more than 300 denarii and given to the poor." And they scolded her. They scolded her. Let's be fair here, hey guys. Only some, not all, were outraged by this lady's action. They saw it, but those that some saw it as a waste. They thought it was a waste to use it on Jesus when she could have sold it and given the money to those who actually needed it more than Jesus. And they scolded the nameless woman for being so wasteful. Now I'm going to give these knockers the benefit of the doubt and say their motives for such thing was not like Judas 4 days earlier in John 12. I reckon they may have been sincere, okay? We don't know. Maybe they really cared about the poor. Wonder what Jesus will say though. Let's look at it. Verse 6, the commendation. Jesus responds. The commendation, verse 6 to 9. Jesus said, "Leave her alone. Why do you trouble her? She has done a beautiful thing to me." That's key. "For you always have the poor with you, and whenever you want, you can do good for them, and you will not always have me. She has done what she could. She has anointed my body beforehand for burial, and truly I say to you, wherever the gospel is proclaimed in the whole world, she has done what she has done will be told in memory of her." So Jesus has a go at them, telling them firstly to leave her alone, guys. Leave her alone. Then in a form of a question, he rebukes them for troubling her, for harassing her. The lady shouldn't be given a hard time for what she just did for him. In Jesus' view, it wasn't a wasteful act. It was a beautiful act. "She has done a beautiful thing to me," Jesus said. What seems like a waste to some, Jesus calls a beautiful thing. Isn't that true? People who don't value Jesus look at us Christians and think, "You guys are weird." If, of course, we're living out a life of valuing Jesus, "You guys are weird." Because there's a clash of values, isn't there? In what you do with your money and how you live your life, what you spend your time with, hopefully there's a clash of values. If not, then we're just worldly. So Jesus here gives three reasons why he commends her actions as beautiful. Firstly, her extravagant act was beautiful because it was to Jesus. That boosts the level of importance, doesn't it? It was to Jesus. Notice, to me. She has done a beautiful thing to me. Which commandment is more important, guys? Love God or love people? Both are really important. Both are very connected, actually, together. But getting down to the very basic, what's more important? Love God or love people? Love God. Why? Who's more important? God or people? God. You see? That's why it's the greatest commandment. Because God's more important. And Jesus says, it's to me. It's to me. And he's saying that in comparison to selling it and doing it for the poor. See, that's important too. Jesus is not saying that caring for the poor, giving alms to the poor is not important. He taught that it was. And poverty was so widespread in Israel. And Jesus is saying that he is more important. That's what he's saying. He's not saying that poor people aren't important. He's saying he's more important. That's why it was a beautiful act. Secondly, her extravagant act was beautiful because of Jesus' physical presence won't be with them forever. He's going to go, and Jesus doesn't speak against the poor. He speaks realistically about them, like sheep are just part and parcel of New Zealand. Like, for example, William and Emily, when you went to New Zealand, did you see sheep? Yeah, that's right. You just see sheep. You think of New Zealand, you think of sheep. And poverty, unfortunately, is part and parcel of our fallen world, is it not? Went to St. James Station from Padstow, St. James, yesterday with the family, and to go to the tower, the tower thing. You may have seen some pictures on the Facebook. When we went to St. James, you just can't help when you go into the city, you see poverty, don't you? You see people sleeping on the streets. In a Western culture, there's still poverty. Believers are commanded to help the poor, particularly in the church, but the poor will always be with us, Jesus said. Therefore, we will always have opportunities to serve them. But for those blessed saints who walked with Jesus when he was physically on earth, their opportunity to love and serve him was short-lived. Because only in a month or so, in a few days he's going to die, he's going to rise, then he's going to appear for, I think, 40 days, I think it was, and then he's gone. His physical presence is gone. Of course, then he gives us his spiritual presence in the person of Holy Spirit. So that's the other reason why I was blessed, because I'm here and I won't be here soon. The poor will always be here. Remember, Jesus prophesied that there will always be famines leading up to the end of the age. Doesn't mean we don't try to counteract it. Doesn't mean that we don't grieve about it. Thirdly, her extravagant act was beautiful because it was prophetic. Okay? Whether the lady knew it or not, her act of anointing was a prophecy. It was an enacted prophecy predicting what Jesus had already foretold, that he must die and be buried. Verse 8, that's what I think Jesus means when he says, she has done what she could. She has anointed my body beforehand for burial. You see that? What does that mean? Well, I think it's a enacted prophecy. People will understand. We will understand with greater clarity what this lady's act of pouring out precious perfume on Jesus' head means when they recognize that he has poured out his blood onto death for his people. Okay, so let me get to the application and draw this message to a close. Remember, number one, the essence of the unwasted life. You tell me, from what we just read and what we just learned from this lady, how can we learn what the essence of the unwasted life is? A life that is beautiful in the eyes of God. Let me try to say it this way, you ready? The essence of the unwasted life is a life of unrestraint adoration of Christ and devotion to Christ. You got that? You can say it different ways. An unrestrained adoration, love, treasuring, valuing of Christ, loving of Christ above all things, and devotion to Christ would be, say, that's the essence of the unwasted life. Christ is the very essence of the unwasted life. To make much of Christ in everything. See, let me say it this way. Jesus, because he's the creator God, is Jesus the creator of the universe? Is that what the Bible teaches? It does. Is he the redeemer of fallen humanity? The only savior? And for him to be the creator and the only redeemer, look at the worth of him. If he was just a mere human and this woman was doing this, like many acts of worship in the Gospels, that is blasphemy. But he's more than just a mere human, isn't he not? He is fully God and fully man. As the perfect prophet, the perfect priest, the perfect king, who came and condescended, okay, born of a virgin birth, live the immaculate, sinless life as fully God and fully man, as our substitute on the cross, he substituted for us, our representative. God the Father punished him in our place for our sin. Because that's what we deserve. And as we'll talk about in the coming weeks in our youth group, why did Jesus have to be fully man and fully God to be our substitute? That's so profound, so wonderful. And he came back to life in victory. And if we believe in him, he takes our sin and he gives us his righteousness and makes us fit for a relationship with God. We are reconciled to God and there makes us fit for a heaven to enjoy God and Jesus Christ forever and ever and ever. And because, as it says in Colossians chapter 1, because all things were created by him and all things therefore are created for him. It says in Colossians 1, let me try to find it. 16. And it says in verse 18 that he is the head of the body, the church. He is the beginning, the firstborn of the dead, that in everything he might be preeminent, that he might be first place, that he might be the all in all. So that is explaining the unwasted life, is it not? The unwasted life. Everything was created so that Jesus would be preeminent. It was created for Jesus. That's what it means to be a Christ-centered church and to try to live a Christ-centered life. Remember from the Philippians, we went through Philippians. For to me, Philippians 1, Paul says, this is the unwasted life, for to me to live is Christ and to die is gain. Then he says in chapter 3 that for me, when I think about life, of course, there's many things in life that are important and purposeful, but when it comes down to it, the main thing is Christ. In life and death. And then he says, because I count everything as loss for the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. I count everything as loss, even this perfume. See that? This lady's living that out, what Paul said. I count, because I see the surpassing worth of Jesus, I count this perfume as loss so that I'm willing to spend it on him and his purposes, because he's more valuable. And she would have done it joyfully. Remember the parable of the hidden treasure. The kingdom of heaven is like a treasure, Matthew 13, 44. The kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in a field, which a man found and covered up. Then in his joy, he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. He sees the King of God's kingdom, Jesus. He sees what it, and he sees Jesus' kingly reign and all that it entails to belong to Jesus. And he sees that that is the most valuable thing, and I'm willing to sacrifice everything to get that thing, to get Jesus, to get his kingdom. And it says, in his joy. It's not a, she didn't, this lady didn't come to Jesus and say, oh, I don't want to give this up. In her joy, she gave it up for Jesus because he was more valuable. It wasn't a waste, people. Sherilyn and Amy, you guys brought a verse. Was it you guys at prayer meeting last night? On Thursday night, Colossians 3:17, and whatever you do in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus. Who shared that and said, wow, that really impacted me, yeah. And whatever you do, you guys, whatever you do in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. That's the unwasted life, isn't it? That's the unwasted life. In everything we do, Christ is center. I'm being motivated by him, for him, because he is the everything to me. That's the unwasted life. And that's what we know, that we're not going to do that perfectly this side of heaven. But that's our goal. That's what we want. We want to live the unwasted life. And anything that involves cost, and it will be costly to other things, it's costly to be a Christian in Iraq. These beautiful Christians who are willing to say, Jesus, you are the treasure and even more important than my health and my family, and I'm willing to pledge my allegiance to you. People can only do that in a God-glorified way when they see that Jesus is more valuable than everything. It's not wasteful. They won't lose a cent. People will say it's wasteful. Why would you do that? Why would you go and be a missionary? That's a waste of a life. Why would you give money to the church? Why would you sacrifice money in the name of Jesus for the poor? Why would you, you know what I'm saying? Why would you spend so much time in serving this Jesus? It's a waste. Really? People say that in ignorance, like I used to do, because they don't know the value of Jesus. That's unbelief that's speaking. So that's the essence of the unwasted life, guys. We need, who's that scientist, Copernicus? What's his name? Who said that, come on. Copernicus. Thank you. Who said what? The earth? We thought that the earth revolved around the sun. Then he said, no. We got it wrong, guys. The earth. No, the sun revolves around the earth. And then he says, no, you got it wrong. The earth revolves around, everything revolves around the sun. To become a Christian, a Copernicus revolution needs to take place, doesn't it? Because before we're a Christian, in our sinfulness, who's the center of our universe? Where everything revolves around me? Yes? And to become a Christian, we need to acknowledge, as we see Christ, see his value, see his preeminence, and we say, Jesus, you're meant to be center. And that's the essence of sin. You're not center in my life. You're not the center of my universe. And so this huge change that happens within us called new birth, being born again, happens where Christ is put at the center. And then we spend our Christian life trying to keep him the center. Is that true? That's the unwasted life. Jesus at the top of the list. Jesus at the center of everything. Jesus is the foundation of everything. And we live to exalt and magnify Jesus in everything because he is so worthy of everything. Number two, very quickly, the effect of the unwasted life. In this passage, what effect do you see? Jesus lived the unwasted life. He devoted his whole, he laid down his whole life doing everything the Father wanted him to do. Not my will, but your will be done. So what was he, did he receive opposition? It says that. People wanted to arrest him and kill him. This woman receives opposition living the unwasted life. She was mocked and she was scolded for being supposedly wasteful. And then in the middle, she gets this, you're not wasting it. It's beautiful. It's beautiful when a person says, I'm going to go to an unreached people group, lay down my life to so that these people out of love for Jesus and love for these people can hear the gospel and be saved. That is a beautiful thing. When you go to work and you're willing to stand up and say, I'm a Christian and look, I love you guys, and you know that you're going to be criticized, you know you're going to be talked behind your back at and made fun of. And you need to keep hearing, Jesus says, that's a beautiful thing. You're doing it for me. Listen, you guys think, you're living to the audience of one. Listen to what Jesus says, not what the world says. And nothing will be of waste. And so how can we live? So 2 Timothy 3:12, indeed all who live, was it? All who desire to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. To live the unwasted life, which is a godly life, which is a cross-centered life, is opposition will come. And Jesus said, you're blessed when it does come for my name's sake. So how can we live the unwasted life? Be captivated by God's grace. Be captivated by Jesus and his grace, and looking back at his grace, and looking at the cross, and are looking presently at his grace, that he continues to forgive me, he continues to love me, he continues to give me strength, that I can do all things through him who gives me strength. He continues to be with me, he continues to sustain me. And then we look forward to the future of his future grace, of our inheritance, where we are co-heirs with Christ. Well, everything, listen to this people, everything God owns, Jesus owns, and everything Jesus owns, we own. We haven't received it yet. Everything that you have is owned by God. But we have an inheritance coming. Let me show you a verse. You think of a heritage. Paul says in 1 Corinthians 3:21-23, so let no one boast in men, for all things are yours. Whether Paul or Apollos or Cephas or the world or life or death or the present or the future, all are yours, and you are Christ and Christ is God's. So let me just say this. This perfume bottle that is very expensive, she goes, go to Luke 7. I want to show you the finish on this. We look back and we say, Jesus, your grace, the cross is so amazing. You've forgiven me so much, and that's all I need. That's satisfying. The Lord is my shepherd, and I shall not want. I don't need anything else. I don't need to cling to this perfume. I don't need to cling to things. And then we also look to the future, and he continues to satisfy us. And then we look to the future and say, do you think I like this whole thing of clinging to, and I own this perfume, it's $40,000. It's going, yes. And God says, you're going to own everything. Everything is yours. You're going to judge angels, the Bible says. Why? Why cling to earthly stuff now? So look at Luke 7. This is the key motivation to living the unwasted life. The event of this lady, the prostitute lady who does the same thing as this unnamed lady in Mark. Look at verse 36. One of the Pharisees asked him to eat with him, and he went into the Pharisee's house and took his place at the table. And behold, a woman of the city who was a sinner, implied prostitute, when she learned that he, Jesus, was reclining at the table of the Pharisee's house, brought an alabaster flask of ointment, and standing behind him at his feet, weeping, she began to wet his feet with her tears and wiped them with the hair of her head and kissed his feet and anointed them with the ointment. Now, when the Pharisee who had invited him saw this, he said to himself, "If this man were a prophet, he would have known who and what sort of woman this is who's touching him, for she is a sinner." And Jesus answering said to him, "Simon, I have something to tell you." And he answered, "Say it, teacher. You don't want to hear this." And then he told a parable. A certain money lender had two debtors. One owed 500 denarii. Remember that? That's must be about a year and a half wages. That's a lot. And 150. And when they could not pay, he cancelled the debt of both. Now, which of them will love him more? You answer me. Which one? The one with the more debt. And he said to him, "You have judged rightly." Sorry. And he says, verse 43, Simon answered, "The one, I suppose, for whom he cancelled the larger debt." And he said to him, "You have judged rightly." Then turning to verse 44, then turning to the woman, he said to Simon, "Do you see this woman? I entered your house. You gave me no water for my feet, but she has wet my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair. You gave me no kiss, but from the time I came in, she has not ceased to kiss my feet. You did not anoint my head with oil, but she has anointed my feet and anointed with an ointment. Therefore, I tell you, her sins, which are many, are forgiven, for she loved much. But he who is forgiven little," what? "Loves little." And he said to her, "Your sins are forgiven." Then those who were able at the table with him began to say amongst themselves, "Who is this who even forgives sins? Well, he's God in human flesh." And he said to the woman, "Your faith has saved you. Go in peace." Do you see that? Two people. One person in unbelief and who didn't see the value in their unbelief, didn't see the value of Jesus, treated Jesus like that. Then you have a prostitute, a religious leader who should know, who should believe in the Messiah, and you have a prostitute come and show the amazing love for Jesus because she believed him, she saw him by God's grace, she saw the value of Jesus, and she knew, listen to this, that Jesus could forgive her sin. And she knew that she, with all her many sins, needed a Savior, and he cancelled all her moral debt. And that's why she loved much. You see that? So the essence of the way to live the unwasted life is to be captivated by God's grace and forgiveness for you. And you don't need to be such an immoral person like that lady to know the depth of your sin. Ask God to reveal your sin. If you feel like there's pride in your heart that says, "Look, I'm a pretty good person. I'm not that bad. I've never done drugs. I've never done some of the bad stuff. I'm even still a virgin." And use that as your badge of honor for your self-righteousness. And God says, "You are unrighteous. You are in need of a Savior." And if you want overflowing love for Jesus and people, you need to see that you don't deserve God's love. You are sinful. You need forgiveness. And one of the greatest stumbling blocks for people who grew up in Christian homes is your own goodness. Because in worldly standards, you are better than a lot of people. Let's pray. Father, we just now commit to you this message and just speak to each one of us wherever our hearts are and do your amazing work, Lord, your amazing loving work. It's amazing how much you love us. Lord, we all need to grow in a deeper understanding of your grace so that more love would overflow to you and to others. Father God, we pray for this. And for those who may have never known you, who the essence, they're not living the unwasted life. You're not the center, Lord Jesus. They haven't come to realize the depth of their sin and the need for you, Jesus, to forgive them. Then may today be the day. You reveal your beauty, your value, your ability to forgive their sin and bring them into your kingdom. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.